May I now invite Dr. Kamal Gupta to take us through his presentation on the time principles in the wound management. Sir, over to you. Thank you, sir.
Thanks, Dr. Pradeep, for your kind words. Yeah, good evening, colleagues. I hope all of you are having good time during a lockout period. So today, the topic which we are going to discuss, it is the time principles of wound bed preparation. So let us see what is there when we talk about time. Now, time is related with wound bed preparation. The first step is debridement, then exudate management, and bacterial balance. Bacterial balance means control of infection. We have to identify and remove the barriers. Now, those are factors which are responsible for prolonged healing of the wound, they have to be removed. And once they are removed, the wound will start healing. Now, once we talk about wound healing, that is where we apply the principle of time. So what do we mean when we talk about time? T stands for tissue. We have to see whether it's viable or non-viable. I stands for infection and inflammation. M is for moisture imbalance. The wound should be properly moist. E stands for edge of the wound, whether they are advancing or they are non-advancing. Now, once a patient comes to us in OPD, so let us start with the patient once he walks in. The most important is when we have a look at the wound, we should know what type of wound we are dealing with. Is it infective, ischemic, infective and ischemic, decubitus, or neuropathic? After that, just perform the assessment according to time criteria. And later on, once assessment is over, then starts the intervention. And once the intervention is there, the wound is either healed or it is not healed. Now, if it is healed, the most important thing at that time is how to go for prevention. Prevention means that the wound does not recur. Now, for that, we can go for offloading, for example, or other preventive measures, like a basic thing like teaching a patient how to take care of the foot in diabetes. Now, in case the wound does not heal, still we have done everything, but still the wound has not healed, we have to start from the beginning. Maybe there are certain factors or comorbidities which are present, which have been either overlooked or which have not been controlled by us. Now, when we talk about wound bed preparation, the first step is cleansing the wound and the surrounding skin. The idea is to remove the debris or the necrotic material, devitalized tissue, all the microorganisms which are present, and to take care of exudate. Now, how to cleanse a wound? Now, the general perception is that the water which is safe for drinking is safe enough for using for cleaning the wound. Now, many of us may not be very comfortable in our mind. So there are the best solution in those circumstances remains normal saline. And of course, commercial cleansers are also available. We shall be discussing them just in coming slides. The most important point to remember is when you are going for cleansing of the wound, at that time, just don't pour the solution or water or normal saline over the wound. You have to take a syringe or a jet pump and then use at least 8 to 10 psi of pressure to remove the necrotic material or the debris which are present over there. So as I said, three steps are going to be of all assessment, interventions and goals. So first of all, coming to tissue, let us see whether it is viable or non-viable. And the first type of tissue which we handle is necrotic tissue. Necrotic basically means it's a dead tissue because of lack of blood supply and oxygenation. Two types are there. Either it is a scar formation, like you can see in the picture, which is at the top. It is either dry, you can make out over here. It is either dry, thick, leathery tissue that is often tan, brown or black in color. And in case it is a slough, that is devitalized protein plus collagen plus fibrin. Now these three things, when they combine together, they form the sloughs. You can see it over here. And it is yellow, tan, green or brown in color and may be moist or loose and stringy in appearance. Now second type of tissue which can be there, that is granulated. So we have to see whether it is healthy or non-healthy. Now this is unhealthy granulation tissue you can make out. It is usually black, dusky red in color. Whereas if the tissue is healthy, at that time it is usually red in color and indicates good healing. Now you can make out the epithelializing surfaces over there. So this is the epithelializing tissue which we have to identify. So it looks shiny pink with shiny pearl appearance. Just see this, the pink and shiny pearl appearance at the margins. So that means it is a epithelializing tissue. Now another thing which we have to see, when a patient comes with a gangrene, whether it is a dry gangrene or it is a wet gangrene. So what is the basic difference? The basic difference is, if a gangrene is wet, it means there is superimposed infection. So we have to look after the tissue, that is the gangrenous part, the slough which is present over there, and at the same time we have to look after the infection also. Now coming to interventions, now the most important intervention remains debridement. And what is debridement? Debridement is removal of non-viable tissue until surrounding healthy tissue is exposed. But still, there may be some contraindications where debridement should not be carried out or cannot be carried out. In case the wound is not infected, then you cannot carry out a debridement. There is no point. Now, in case there is peripheral arterial disease, you are not able to palpate both the pulses, that is posterior tibial artery or the this thing dorsalis pedis, that is again a contraindication for debridement. And in case the eschar is stable and especially on the heel, please do not go for debridement. I will let you know, I will just share with you how we can deal with such cases. So what are the indications? Infected wound, necrotic wound and sloughy wound. Advantages, the most important is that once you have removed the necrotic tissue, we can assess the size of the wound. And once the dead tissue is removed, the underlying pus that also is drained. And the most important part of debridement is to convert a chronic wound into an acute one. So when not to debride, as I said, when both the peripheral pulses are absent or ABI, that is ankle brachial index, is less than 0.7. So what to do? I think the best thing in such cases is to refer the case to your vascular surgeon friend. Let him take a call, let him go for angiography, and let him take a call whether he wants to go for angioplasty or any other procedure. Now, coming to the types of debridements which are available with us, it is autolytic debridement, enzymatic, mechanical, surgical, or biological. So we'll be discussing one by one. So what is autolytic? The principle behind autolytic debridement is that it uses body's own enzymes and moisture with hydrogel, hydrochloride, and transpirant. So this is, you can see, the dry eschar is present all over on the plantar aspect. So how to approach these patients? First of all, don't think about debridement. Make multiple incisions, like you can see over there, and then do dressings using hydrogel. The best example which we are using in our routine practice is intraset gel. Now, once you have applied gel, maybe you can go for a dressing twice a day in case you think you require it. Otherwise, once a day dressing is sufficient. Now, this is a slow method, but it's a very effective method. So all the tissue, eschar, which is there, it comes out gradually. But it is not ideal for infected wound. As I said, sometimes debridement should not be carried out in case the wound is non-infected. But in case it's an infected wound, you can go for debridement. Now coming to the enzymatic debridement. Now you can see this slough. So slough, as I said, is a combination of collagen, fibrin, elastin, and nucleoproteins. So what is the principle? It digests the devitalized extracellular material which is present in the wound. Now this type of debridement, if you go, it is faster as compared to the autolytic debridement, where we use hydrogels. And limitations, the enzymes do not affect dry eschar. Like when I was showing you last slide, I said go for hydrogel. So it is better not to use enzymatic debridement. But yes, some surgeons, they do use enzymatic debridement when the dry eschar is present over there. And how much to apply? Now, what they say is that it should be nickel thickness. And what is meant by nickel thickness? That means it is 0.1 mm sort of a coating over the wound. In routine, the ointments which we are using is Debridase, which is a combination of papain and urea, and Zotobac. Zotobac is octinidase. Now, when we talk about Debridase, it contains papain and urea, as I said. Now, papain is a product from papaya, and it acts on the wound and has proteolytic activity. Urea enhances the effect of papaya. So that is the reason Debridase, it has got an effect. And that is why papain and urea, they are, you know, in a symbiotic relationship with each other. Now coming to Zotobac, that is octinidine, another very good, reagent which is available. Now, it is available in India mainly in the ointment form, but yes, abroad both sprays and ointment, they are available. So coming to the next, that is mechanical debridement. So all of us are very well aware of all these things. You know, hydrotherapy is there for whirlpool. Now, what do we mean by hydrotherapy? Basically, is we immerse the patient's foot into a tub containing water. Disadvantage is that the surrounding skin that gets macerated. The wound may be overhydrated. Of course, the debris or the loose slough may come out. Then pulse lavage, that is you are putting the solution, whatever solution you are using, with pressure. And similar is the principle when we use for Versajet. That is a hydrosurgical, I will just discuss with you. And then we have got ultrasonic debridement. Now, this is not very suitable for larger wounds. Moreover, it is very expensive. The equipment cost around 25 lakhs, a good ultrasonic debridement equipment. And I don't know how many hospitals can afford that. And moreover, the recurring cost in ultrasound debridement is quite high. Now, this is a patient who had presented to us after a roadside accident. The stitching was already done outside. You can make out the stitched wound over here. Subsequently, after 8 to 10 days, he developed necrosis in this part of the bone. So we took this patient for debridement with Versajet. So Versajet has got a quality that it removes only the necrotic part of the bone, whereas the normal tissue which is there, that remains intact. So that is very good as compared to surgical debridement, because once we are going for surgical debridement, the normal healthy tissue may also be removed. So that is how necrotic tissue was removed. You can make out over here, and this is the final wound healing. Now the pressure, which normally I said 8 to 10 psi, over here the pressure with Versajet is almost 1000 miles an hour. That is the speed of a jet. Maybe that is the name. It is Versajet. Now this is another sort of dressings which are available, a sort of debridement which is available, that is wet to dry dressing. Now this is something which has been used since ages. All the GPs and many of our clinician friends, colleagues, they must be using. And the advantage, it is very simple and inexpensive. And how you do it? Just take a gauze, autoclave it. So once you have got a sterile gauze, make it wet using normal saline, apply it over the wound, dress the wound, and the principle will be, once it gets dry, the loose fluff or the necrotic tissue that gets adhered to the surface of the gauze, and that is a principle also behind wet to dry dressing. In case there's a lot of exudate, you may have to change the dressing maybe twice or thrice in a day. Otherwise, once a day dressing is quite sufficient. Disadvantage, it is a painful sort of a debridement. Once the gauze that gets adherent with the base of the wound, then you have to put normal saline, or many people use Revlon also to separate it out of the wound. Otherwise, it is a painful sort of debridement. And now we have got so many different things where I think they are better mode of debridement as compared to wet to dry dressing. Surgical debridement, all of us are very well aware. We use either scalpel or laser or hydrosurgical device, that is a Versajet device. The most important thing is, once you are planning to go for surgical debridement, it should either be performed by a surgeon, or you should know how to perform surgical debridement. Even if you are a GP or a clinician where you have not any training in the surgical department, then it's better to avoid it, because there may be risk of bleeding, there may be underlying vessels, you may cut it. So that is something which should be left ideally for the surgeons. Now coming to the biological debridement, so this is basically a maggot therapy where the principle is that the larvae, they feed on and destroy the dead and living tissue of the living host. So these are sterile maggots which are available. In India still they are not very frequently available, but yes, in countries like Malaysia and all, it's a very common sort of debridement which is being used. So coming to the goals, debridement is a complete science. So our goal is to convert a chronic wound into an acute one. And points to remember, please remember when to debride, but when not to debride also. And how much to debride. Please do not remove the normal tissue which is present over there in the surrounding area. Now coming to the second part, that is infection or inflammation. Now the most important is assessment. Now as you can see, very different, you know, terminologies have been used. Contamination, colonization. So let us see what is contamination. Contamination is that bacteria are present but they are not multiplying. Colonization, the bacteria, they are present and they are multiplying also. For example, normal gut flora which is present in our body. Now once there is contamination or colonization, it doesn't require any sort of antibiotic or any treatment. You have to just keep a watch on it. That is the reason it is mentioned, vigilance. But when there is a response from the host, means bacteria are present and there is a response from the host, the condition is called infection. And once infection is there, the most important thing is the biofilm. We will come to biofilm later. So infection, which is there, may be local or it may be spreading, that is involving the surrounding skin, or there may be systemic infection. That means either bacteremia or septicemia can be there in a patient, or the patient may be in septic shock. Now that is the point, once the infection starts, where the treatment is required. So once a patient walks in, now by looking at the wound or the dressing, can we make out what type of patient we are going to deal with? Well, if the color of the dressing or the wound is thick brown with little odor, it means you are dealing with Staph aureus. But if it is greenish, that means it is Pseudomonas. But if it is fecal smell, that means it is bacteroid species which is present over there. Now this is a grading system based on international parameters or international guidelines, how to assess the wound, whether it is, what type of infection it is, whether it is mild, moderate or severe, and how to grade it. Well, when no signs of local infection are there, that is graded as grade 1, and that means it is uninfected. But in case there is local infection on the skin and the subcutaneous tissue is also involved, that is grade 2, infection is rated as mild. Moderate or grade 3 is when the local infection with erythema is more than 2 centimeters, or deeper structures, that is deeper to skin and subcutaneous tissue, they are also involved. And grade 4, when there is generalized, you know, spread of the disease, of the infection, like bacteremia or septicemia, then it is a severe infection and it is graded as grade 4. Just remember that all the signs of systemic infection like fever, tachycardia, respiratory rate more than 20, PCO2 less than 32, and TLC more than 12, all these signs are present when the systemic part of the infection is present. Now, based on this, how to choose an antibiotic? Well, if the infection is mild, then you can choose cefalexin, augmentin or clindamycin. Now, a combination is also available, that is cefalexin along with clavulanic acid or clindamycin is there. And but in case there is methicillin resistant Staphylococcus aureus, the popularly known as MRSA, the drug of choice remains erythromycin. In case it's a moderate infection, then you can go for cefazolin, vancomycin or ampicillin with sulbactam. But if it's a severe infection, we have to go for piperacillin with tazobactam. Now whatever sort of antibiotics we use, the antibiotics duration remains 1 to 2 weeks for mild, 2 to 4 weeks for moderate, and maybe up to 4 weeks for severe infection. Now this is the report which we normally get in our lab, in our hospital, in our department. Now, whenever a patient comes, we go for removal of slough or debridement. It is a deep tissue which should be sent, or I will say it is mandatory to send the deep tissue for culture sampling. Please do not send the superficial swabs. The organisms which are deep might be totally different. So take the deep tissue, collect it as a sample, ideally in Pepton water, or you can use normal saline, and send it to a lab where you can get MIC values. MIC means minimal inhibitory concentration. Now, what are the advantages? You come to know which is the most sensitive drug and maybe sometimes the least expensive drug based on MIC value. So in our lab, this is in our hospital, this is a routine practice. But in case you are not able to get this sort of report, still culture sensitivity plays a very important role when we talk about diabetic foot infections. Now coming to the interventions. Now, as I mentioned about the biofilms, biofilms are probably the most important single cause of persistent and delayed healing of the wound. So let us see what a biofilm is and how we can manage it. Biofilm is adherence of bacteria and fungi to the surface of the wound, leading to delayed healing. Now, normally, if you see this picture, it is translucent. It is shiny yellowish green color. You can make out over here. That is a very thin layer of biofilm which is present over here. And it is formed normally after 24 hours. 60% of chronic wounds may contain biofilms, and 6% of acute wounds may also have biofilms. And the significance of biofilms, it decreases the drug penetration. So once the biofilm is present, the drug which we think is going to penetrate, it does not penetrate. Then it prevents formation of granulation tissue. The inflammatory phase, that is phase 2 of the wound healing, is prolonged. Then it reduces oxygen supply to the wound, and it impairs migration and proliferation of keratocytes. Now, we know keratocytes, they produce keratin, which is a type of protein which helps in the healing of the wound. So once the biofilm is present, the most important is to get rid of it. Then the question is, when to suspect biofilm? Well, if there is delayed healing in spite of the optimal standards of care, there is failure to respond to antibiotic or antiseptic solutions which we are using, there are frequent episodes of inflammation or infection, high levels of exudate without associated inflammation are present, or you see a gelatinous substance on the wound. Now, whenever these conditions are present, always suspect a biofilm. So once a biofilm is present or you're suspecting, let us see how to remove it. Well, the most important is wound cleansing, repeated debridement, and application of the topical antiseptic lotion. Now, so many things are available in market. It is difficult to choose whether it is what you should use as antiseptic solution. Is it Sevelon? Is it Betadine? Is it hydrogen peroxide? Or it is silver? Or any other preparation which we have already discussed, like Debritis or Zorobax. Now, just remember, first of all, say no to Betadine, Sevelon, hydrogen peroxide, and why? Well, Betadine, all of us know, is povidone iodine. It is in vogue since early 80s, but it does not cross biofilm. So in case you are cleaning the diabetic wound or any wound with Betadine, please stop doing it. Because once it does not cross biofilm, it is not going to promote any granulation tissue. Secondly, it is a cytotoxic drug. Lot of literature is there now on the internet. You can go through it. It inhibits with the formation of fibroblasts and the collagen, which are very important for healing of the wound. And in large wounds, in case the wounds are big and they are open, if you use 7.5 or maybe 10% of this thing, povidone iodine, there may be local absorption of iodine. You can read it about local absorption of iodine with systemic effect of iodine in Goodman-Gilman also. It is very clearly mentioned over there. Cevalon, that contains citramine, it does not cross biofilm. So once it does not cross, there is no point of using Cevalon. Hydrogen peroxide, again, it is a cytotoxic drug. Another theory is that once H2O2, that is hydrogen peroxide, the nascent oxygen is released, the aerobic bacteria which are present, they may start multiplying at a higher level, or you can say there may be increased colonization of bacteria because of this. Now let us see, if there's no betadine or Cevalon or hydrogen peroxide, what to do? Yes, the ideal solution these days which we can use is silver based solution. Now first of all, let me just share with you, do not confuse silver wash with silver ointment. I will come to that, but first, why silver? Now most important, it crosses the biofilm. So that is what we want whenever we are using any antiseptic solution. Secondly, we know the normal skin pH is around 5.5 to 5.6. It is acidic skin. That is the reason bacteria, they do not grow over the skin. But once the wound has become alkaline, once the wound has wound is there, the pH changes to alkaline medium. That is 7.15 to 8.9. And silver brings the pH back from alkaline to the acidic. So that is the reason you get a cytotoxic effect which is present with silver. And as I said, that it is available as a silver wash or as a silver based ointment. Now once you want to go for irrigation of the wound, silver wash is the best solution. It contains 10 ppm of concentration. But in case you want to dress a wound, at that time it is better to use any ointment which contains silver. And in silver ointment, it is 32 ppm of the silver ion concentration which is present. And these days, the agents which we are getting, they all contain nano silver crystals. So aim of using silver dressing, it reduces bioburden, that is controlling of infection, and it prevents systemic spread. Now coming to the mechanism, how this silver acts, the most important part is electron transportation. There is an exchange of ions between sodium and the silver. Secondly, the silver, when it is in the ionic form, it binds with the DNA of the bacteria, and hence it causes stoppage, or it prevents further multiplication of bacteria by causing cytotoxic effect. And in the last, it acts on the cell membrane, again leading to structural damage, leading to a bactericidal effect. Now just remember, when you are cleaning a wound or you are irrigating a wound, please use silver wash and not normal saline. Why not normal saline once you're using a silver ointment? The reason is very simple. Normal saline, all of us know, is NaCl. Now once it gets mixed with silver, then silver chloride compound is formed. And once silver chloride compound is formed, which is formed normally within 6 hours, the silver is not going to work. So make sure that it is not normal saline, but a silver wash which is used for the irrigation of wound. Another similar thing which is available in market is PHMB, that is poly hexamethylene vibrionide. Now the mechanism is similar to silver. It interacts with bacteria, interacts with the cell membrane, and causes the cell death. But once you are using PHMB solution, please do not use along with silver. What we have seen in our practice, although the company people never discussed with us, they never told us, but by mistake when we use this PHMB with silver ointment, there is immediately bluish green discoloration. So if you open the wound after 2 days, suddenly you will realize, how come there is Pseudomonas infection? No, it is not Pseudomonas. Greenish color means Pseudomonas, but it was not there. That was because of the reaction of PHMB with silver, giving rise to bluish green color of the skin. Now goals, as I said, identify and remove biofilm, use proper antibiotic depending upon the culture sensitivity report, and do take care of all the comorbid conditions which are present, whether it is just controlling of simple diabetic status of a patient. And just remember, at this stage, please get HbA1c done every 3 months for all the patients. We have to maintain between 6 to 6.5 for optimal healing of the wound, and secondly, to prevent the recurrence. Now coming to the third, that is moisture. So how to assess? Now it is, it all depends upon our clinical sense, how we can assess the moisture in the wound. We can make out how much aggregate is there, whether it is mild, moderate or high, on based on our clinical sense. But yes, there are still some parameters like a wound sensor, although I have never used it, but yes, it is available in market. So according to that, in case there is one drop, that indicates a dry wound. But in case there are more than 5 drops, that indicates a wet wound. But I think it is an absolute clinical sense from where we can judge what type of wound we are dealing with. Now suppose it is a dry wound, like a simple scar formation on a small area. As I said earlier, the dressing of choice or the mode of treatment of choice remains dressing with hydrogel. Example, Intracet gel. But in case it is a wet wound, then the most important is to remove the excess moisture or the exudate which is present over there. And to remove that, we can use foam or calcium alginate, maybe gelling fiber. And the most important part, we can go for negative pressure wound therapy called VAC. I will be coming to VAC in the coming slides. Now coming to the edge of the wound, assess whether the edges are advancing or they are non-advancing. Now in case they are advancing, see this wound. Now that means it's an ideal wound. That is thin epithelial margin, which you can see on all around, and the tissue is pulping to translucent. They just see this. So these are absolutely advancing margins, and the wound is getting healed. And once it is non-advancing, the margins may look like round curves, as you can see over here in this picture. Then it may be a callus formation. We know callus formation normally takes place on the neurogenic wounds, or maybe neuropathic, or maybe where pressure ulcers are there, and then the edges may be undermined. Now just keep a basic principle in mind: any wound which has not healed in the last 6 months, please go for biopsy from the margins. Now that is something very, very important. As such, when it's a non-advancing wound, we do intervene and go for surgical debridement. That is a sharp debridement. As I said earlier, the idea is to convert a chronic wound into an acute one. But once you are doing so, please take the biopsy from the margins and send it for histopathology examination to rule out any malignancy. You may be dealing with a malignant wound and maybe we do not know at that time. Other interventions which can be there, it is either a VAC or PRP, or the latest which has to add, which is being added, is MCOPLAST. So I would like to just discuss with you all the different types of interventions which are present. Now coming to the dressing selection, depending upon time guideline. So let us see what time guide has to tell us what sort of dressing is required. The most important is, first of all, go for proper management of exudate. Now generalized principle which we follow, in case it is low, just go for hydrogel dressing or maybe hydrochloride. If it is moderate, you can go for alginate, that is calcium alginate. We know it is available in the form of sheets or it is available in the form of ropes. Now ropes are ideal for tunneling. And in case the exudate is heavy, at that time either go for foam dressing or preferably go for NPWT, that is a VAC therapy. So coming to the types of dressings, they may be absorbent. For example, I just mentioned that is a foam dressing which, you know, soaks all the exudate which is present, or alginate. Alginate can soak up to 20 times than its normal weight. Moisturizing dressing, as I said, hydrogel, and other types, they include mainly collagen dressing. Now collagen is available in the form of sheets or granules. The principle is, as we know, there are 31 different types of collagen which are present in the body. Now this is a bovine collagen dressing which is being made, and the principle is that it enhances the fibroblast activity leading to contraction of the bone. Now MCOPLAST, now this is previously, if you remember, if my senior colleagues were, if in case they are watching this today's talk, today's webinar. Now, when we were in medical colleges way back in 80s or early 90s, now we used to use placenta from our gynae ward. Obstetric ward, we used to go take the placenta, wash it with normal saline, apply over the wound. Now, this is something, a similar product. The only difference is, it's a dried up, a combination of amnion and corium. And of course, it is with PHMB and without PHMB. In our practice, we use all the dressing of MCOPLAST with PHMB, because this is PHMB, as I already said, it crosses a biofilm, it has got a cytotoxic activity. So the bacteria which are present over the skin, they just become dead. And the healing is quite fast. So MCOPLAST is available in different sizes. So I will show you one case study where we had gone for MCOPLAST during our initial, when we started MCOPLAST at the initial stages. Now other modalities of treatment which are present, as I said, it is NPWT, then PRP. PRP, I will just be sharing one video also with you, how to make it in the lab and what are the, you know, principles. Then triple LT. Now this is something which is extensively used in our hospital, in our department, that is low level laser therapy. Then hyperbaric oxygen, popularly known as HPO. And of course, now they say oxygen therapy, that is oxygen directly from the atmosphere. Now equipment is available. Yeah, that converts oxygen from the air. I mean, it takes the air and converts into oxygen. And then you can put, you know, a plastic sort of a envelope or a wound cover, and then insert the pipe into the wound, and there may be local concentration of oxygen and local absorption. Now that is the latest thing which is now available, and we had a webinar from US a few days back. So maybe at a later stage, till now they have not started the oxygen therapy equipment, but maybe very shortly we will be getting in India, and that is quite cheap as compared to hyperbaric oxygen therapy. Now, first of all, coming to the negative pressure wound therapy. Now, the principle is, it improves local blood supply. It leads to wound contraction and size reduction. It induces granulation and angiogenesis, and it reduces edema. So indications post debridement. So once you have gone for removal of the infection, now please note, in the presence of infection, bag should not be applied. But once you have removed most of the fluff, very little bit fluff is now there, which you cannot remove surgically or maybe with other type of debridement. That is the indication for bag. It actually it promotes granulation tissue. The wound size contracts. So the only thing we have to see that the infection is minimal at that time. Secondly, once the granulation tissue is promoted, it covers the exposed bones, capsules, and the tendons, and the contraindication in the presence of osteomyelitis. And in case you think there may be malignancy, or maybe the vessels after debridement, they lie exposed, or maybe the nerves are lying exposed. Now those are the contraindications where VAC should not be used. Few considerations. Now once there is ischemia, at least one pulse should be palpable before you think of applying VAC. So that is very, very important. Just bear in mind, whenever you go for VAC, please palpate the dorsalis pedis as well as posterior tibial artery. If any of one is present, then it is a good indication to go for VAC. So this is how VAC is applied. I will just share a small video with you. Now this is a patient. Now you can see this. This is a large wound of the calf muscle. Now first step is cleaning of the wound. And second is, in this patient, we have gone for sprinkling of granules of collagen. Now this is optional. If you want, you can go for sprinkling of collagen granule, or if you want, you can directly go for a VAC application. So that is how the foam is inserted. Now we have to just make it airtight so that negative pressure can be applied later on. So a small hole is made, and that is how the equipment is applied, and the pressure which is given, that is approximately 125 millimeters of mercury. So the advantage is that there is a canister which is attached over here. The exudate which is present, it all comes out. So depending upon the reduction in exudate, as I said, that in high exudate, go for NPWT. Now, once the canister starts feeling less, it means now that it's not a very high exudative wound any longer. At that time, VAC can be removed. You can go for 3 sittings, 4 sittings, or 5 sittings in case they are required, depending on the amount of exudate which is present in the wound. Now, coming to the second modality of treatment, that is PRP. It's a platelet-rich plasma. Now, mechanism of action, it reduces inflammation by suppressing cytokines. It has got both mitotic as well as chemotactic property, and it contains high level of platelet, clotting, and growth factor, which helps in the wound healing. Now let us see how we can make PRP in our labs. Now if you go on the net, there are so many publications and there are so many different techniques. Now I will just share with you the technique which we have adopted in our lab. So first of all, we draw 8.5 ml of blood in each vial. Now 2 vials normally we take, but yes, you can take up to 50 ml of blood. Now 1 vial normally contains 8.5 ml of blood along with 1.5 ml of ACD solution. So you take the blood, mix it well, and after that, first step is centrifuge at 500 RPM per RPM. There is automatic counting on the machine. Now, many people do recommend that it should be done at 1500 RPM at a first step. So, depends upon which literature you are following. So, in our practice, we go for 500 RPM as a first step for centrifugation. Now, what happens, you can make out three layers over here. The first layer, I'm sorry, I will just... I hope you can see this. Okay, I will just. So that is how the blood is withdrawn. Now two wires you can see. First rotation 500 RPM, I have discussed with you. So see this. Now the upper layer is a plasma layer. In between there is a tiny buffy coat, and below that there's RBC deposits. You can make out over here. So the most important for us is these two layers, the buffy coat as well as the upper plasma layer. Then separate it out. Now you can make out the two upper layers you are supposed to separate. So that is from first tube, and that is the second tube. Just separate them out. Now again go for centrifugation. Now this time you centrifuge at 4000 RPM per minute, and finally you get two layers. The top upper one is a plasma, the platelet poor plasma, and below it it is platelet rich plasma. So this is the lowermost, which is important for us. Now that is a calcium chloride solution, which is used in a ratio of 1:10. 1:10 for activation of the, you know, PRP. So once PRP is ready, shift it to any sterile vial, and you can use it for local dressing of the wound or maybe local insertion at the margin of the wound. So coming to the next, that is triple LT, that is a low level laser therapy which we use in routine. The principle is photobioactivation, that is you know, ROS, that is a reactive oxygen species circle is there, so it goes for ROS modulation. Then angiogenesis, that is promotion of, you know, formation of new blood vessels, and photovaporization. Now with laser, like when we use laser for in proctology or for varicose veins, that is 1470 nanometers wavelength. Here it is 905, so the vaporization from the wound is very, very less. It is less than 3%. So that it keeps the wound moist. And that is how we use it. Very simple way. This is abdominal wound, patient presented. Now their preset, you know, codes are available. So we just preset it. After that, the energy which is used is 5 joules per square centimeter. So this is activation of laser. You can see that each point we keep it for approximately 3 minutes. So depending on the size of the wound, 5 joules per square centimeter energy is given. Now coming to HBO, we know that TCPO2 measurement is very important before going for hyperbaric oxygen. If it is less than 30 millimeter of mercury, that is the absolute indication for HPO. Now coming to few case presentations. 65-year-old female patient, diabetic since last 10 years, she presented with wound on the plantar aspect of both the feet. Now this started when the patient had gone to a gurdwara, which is a very common practice in Punjab, bare feet. And after that, these ulcers, they appeared and they were non-healing. You can make out the callus formation over here. And our approach was callus removal, PRP injection on all the margins, hydrogel dressing, and offloading. 56-year female, diabetic since last 6 years, she had presented with a non-healing wound after amputation of the second toe on the left foot. Now you can make out the cavity over here. Now this was a non-healing wound. Now at that time we had not started using Amcoplast, but Amcoplast people came, they gave us two samples, you know, for demonstration purposes. Now we used 3 by 3 centimeter in this patient, and you can make out complete healing of the wound. It may take 6 to 8 weeks, you know, overall, but just see how nicely the wound has healed. Now this is a complete healing, and initially we used hydrogel dressing, but when the response was not that good, then we went for Amcoplast. 55 years old male patient, diabetic since last 5 years, presented with wound on the dorsum of the foot. You can make out a very bad wound over here. Now this is a necrotic area. This is necrosed completely, you know, wet gangrene sort of a picture was there. Now this patient, when he came to us, patient clearly said, sir, I have been advised to go for amputation. Can you save my foot? So we just said, no promise. Let us see what best can be done in your case. So first of all, we went for surgical debridement, as I mentioned, you know, when we were talking about wet gangrene. And then we went for few sessions of, you know, wet followed by laser. Now laser we use because it is supposed to be, as I said, the promotion of granulation tissue. And many times it has been mentioned that it has got a bactericidal activity also. And after that, the wound was ready for grafting, but patient refused to go for split skin grafting. He said, already I am having one wound on my body. I do not want to go for grafting. So we have taken this patient for Amcoplast. This patient is still under our treatment. As I mentioned, the date is 11th of May. Another case, 67-year-old male patient. Now this patient had chronic limb ischemia, for which he had, you know, gone for right leg angioplasty. And the patient presented to us with this condition. You can make out that there is a fluff which is present over there, but otherwise the wound was quite good. We went for surgical debridement followed by a few sessions of wet, and after that, once the granulation tissue was there, the cavities and all, they had healed. There was nothing below the margin. We went for skin grafting. So that is how the final wound looks. Now, many time people say, we talk about granulation tissue, we talk about unhealthy or healthy granulation tissue, but what to do when there is hypergranulation tissue? That is the commonest problem which many of us, you know, we face in our day-to-day practice. So commonest causes, first of all, try to figure out why the hypergranulation tissue is there. The commonest causes are wound infection, excess inflammation, presence of a foreign body, or maybe friction. And treatment options, you can go for silver nitrate, that is like a caustic dressing, it acts as a caustic agent over the wound. Then you can go for hypertonic normal saline dressing, you can go for corticosteroid local application, and you can go for sharp debridement, or maybe sometimes the curetting is sufficient, you know, of the hypergranulation tissue. And of course, surgical laser can also be used. But whenever you are facing this problem, always send a specimen for histopathology. Do rule out malignancy. And in the last, this is necrotizing fasciitis. This is not a part of time management, but just wanted to share with you. Commonest organism is streptococcus, and the wound normally involves superficial fascia and connective tissue below the skin. The symptoms, they are sore pain and large blister formation. You can see over here the blister formation having a dark colored fluid over here. And how to approach? Go for IV antibiotics, blood transfusions, control of systemic infection, hyperbaric oxygen, and surgical interventions. So take home message, the diabetic foot ulcer management, it is a multidisciplinary approach. Do involve, like I as a surgeon have never written any medicine for diabetes. So do involve a physician or endocrinologist. Do involve a vascular surgeon in case you think he is required. Do involve a plastic surgeon for a flap or split skin grafting if you are not doing it yourself. Then tissue management by proper debridement is a very important thing, you know, for wound preparation. Infection control is another very important thing. And in the last, go for proper offloading and diabetic control. Well, as they always say, the most dangerous way is we have always done it this way. So many of us may feel that we have always done the dressing with betadine or hydrogen peroxide, but I think now there is a time for change. Thank you very much.
Well, sir, thank you so much for your presentation. I would like to thank Dr. Kamal Gupta for his enlightening presentation and a very stepwise approach towards wound and time management, importance of time management in the chronic wounds. It is our great honor to have you with us for question and answers. The forum is now open for the question and answers. Sir, the first question that is coming from for today's evening is from Dr. Naval Asawa from Mangalorepir, Maharashtra. How and when to decide to cut necrotic tissue and up to which limit in the OPD level? And you know, when to refer?
Yeah, I think as a clinician, once you are working as a GP, you may not be having a proper OT, but still the skin, superficial fascia, and maybe the subcutaneous tissue, that easily can be removed. So there is no contraindication that you require a surgeon, but in case, you know, it's better to avoid any vessels or maybe tendons or any nerves which are present over there. That is the only precaution you are supposed to take. Otherwise, there is nothing like this that you cannot do, a surgeon can do better. Even in case you have got, you know, little bit training in the surgical field, that is sufficient for you to remove it at your place.
All right, sir. Sir, Dr. Naveen Monga from Kalanwali, Haryana, he's interested to know why we should not wash with normal saline. Why silver washes are needed and why can't we use normal wash with normal saline?
No. I said you can wash the wound with normal saline. But in case we are using silver preparation, then please do not use with normal saline as it is going to form a compound. Otherwise, in routine where we are not using silver, we are using all, you know, for irrigation, the solution of choice is normal saline.
Yes, sir. Perfect, sir. Sir, Dr. Gurucharan Bir Singh from Jalandhar, Punjab, he is asking the role of Placentrex gel dressing instead of Acmoplast due to financial considerations. So maybe patients may not be offering, have a financial economic status of offer Acmoplast. So can we use Placentrex gel in those patients?
Yeah, definitely. You know, Placentrex is basically, it is growth factors which are available. Plasmin is the trade name which is available in the market. It costs around, I think, 1100 rupees or so. And that is perfect. You can use it. There's no contraindication.
Right, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Sir, Dr. Sangeeta from Mumbai, Maharashtra, is asking the role of methylene blue stain in debridement. Is it helpful?
Please go on, Dr. Please go on.
As the question continues, if excess of the wound discharge plan, doesn't it misguide the treating physician?
First of all, just Dr. Sangeeta, methylene blue as a marking, if you're talking, I do not know, but it has no role in debridement. Just remember that methylene blue, when we use a lot of methylene blue, that is sterile methylene blue, which is available in the form of vials, you know, that we use in all the patients where we want to go for have an analgesic effect. Now, what methylene blue does, the principle behind methylene blue is that it causes a coating. Now, once we have gone for debridement, the nerve endings, they become, you know, demyelinated. So this methylene blue, it goes for a coating. It causes a coating over the nerve endings and hence it reduces the pain. So that is a principle which we follow as far as the methylene blue is concerned. Secondly, when you talk about excessive exudate and how to manage it, I think the best thing is once you go for proper assessment, as I said, first go for the debridement of the necrotic tissue and all. But once the excessive debridement is there, in my opinion, there is nothing better than negative pressure wound therapy. That is NPWT or VAC therapy.
Okay, right, sir. Sir, Dr. Rajiv Dhawan from Jalandhar, He's asking how to differentiate between a neuropathic wound and ischemic wound.
Ischemic wound, yeah, please.
Very basic questions. How to actually identify neuropathic and ischemic wound?
You know, neuropathic, we know because of loss of sensation, as the name indicates. Ischemia means the pulses, peripheral pulses, whether it is dorsalis pedis or posterior tibial artery, that is not palpable. Now, how to differentiate? First of all, go for ABI and TBI. If ABI, TBI is more than 0.7, it means it's a non-ischemic ulcer. But in case, and go secondly, go for biopsy.
Okay.
In case there is loss of sensation on the foot, it means you're dealing with a neuropathic ulcer. So that is based on the investigation.
Right, sir. Because blood supply is very much needed for effective wound healing, so Dr. Yes. Suresh Kumar Agrawal from Balasur, Odisha is asking how to proceed for a wound healing in a low vascular supply area.
I think in case you are not able to palpate both the pulses, even if one is palpable, that is sufficient, you know, for the healing of the wound. But in case both the pulses are not palpable, then please do not go for debridement. The first step you should go for is angiography. Go for peripheral angiography, refer it to your vascular surgeon friend, colleague. Go for that and let him decide what is best for the patient. Maybe ballooning is required, because nowadays, if you talk to a vascular surgeon, they can open the vessels even which are present in the toes.
Right. As pointed out in your presentation, sir, biofilms are very complicated things. Dr. Rajiv Kumar Singh is asking, sir, how sometime biofilm present, when biofilms are present, they delay the wound healing. So what should we do to take care of these biofilms?
The basic step which you should do is, first of all, whenever you're suspecting a biofilm, I think it is better to curate the wound. Go for light curating, or maybe with a dry gauze piece. You just place it on the wound, and after that, just clean it. So the biofilm part will be removed. Second is, use those solutions which can penetrate biofilm, like as I said, silver or PHMB.
Yes, sir. So means shallow sloughing of the wound is needed, curating.
Absolutely.
Right. Sir, Dr. Sanjay from Bangalore, Karnataka is asking, which are the factors, local and systemic, which delay the wound healing? Besides glycemic control and neuropathy, what are the other factors that delay the wound healing?
You know, there are intrinsic and extrinsic factors. And, you know, I have not discussed on that because that is not a part of time management. But I think I would like to show him a slide. Just amongst the other questions are taken. So we will come to that. I will share one slide with
you. Yes, sir. Sir, your advice for Usol, because in one of your slides you suggested Usol, can it be used in diabetic foot wounds? Dr. Rajiv Kumar from Mumbai.
Yeah, people do use Usol. It's a freshly prepared solution. In our practice, we are not using it. But yes, it's one of the solutions which is being used.
Yes, sir. Like you already pointed out, there is a no to povidine-iodine, no to hydrogen peroxide. There was a question from Dr. Gaurav Reddy, which you already answered. What is the role of Usol and hydrogen peroxide in diabetic wounds? Is there any role in diabetic wounds, sir?
Hey, Usol, as I said, I have not been using. Hydrogen peroxide, as already I mentioned, it should not be used because it's a cytotoxic solution.
Yes, sir. Sir, Dr. D.K. Mittal from Kapurthala, Punjab, wanted to understand the T-back, comparison of T-back antibiotic with silver formulations, like silver hydrogen, which is better? Yes.
I don't know the content of T-back, but I think it is octanidine, which is there. Now, octanidine is a very good content as far as enzymatic is concerned. Same is silver. So it depends upon your experience. If you are happy with T-back, please continue with it. Like we use silver in some patients, we use octanidine in some Zotobac which is there, or maybe it is a T-back, it's the same thing. And maybe in some patients we do use Depidase. You know. So it depends upon, you know, whatever the choice is there, because they all cause enzymatic except for the silver. Silver is helps in healing out.
So I think T-back contains mupirocin.
Yeah, that is another verb. Yeah, you can use it. There is no problem. There is no contraindication for that.
Yeah, got it, sir. Sir, Dr. Nagendra Prasad Jaiswal from Indore is asking role of cuticerin, NET, and oxaferin solution in diabetic wounds.
No, I am not aware of that. We are not using it.
GauzeNet, sir. Yes, sir. Right, sir. Sir, there is very, very interesting question that is coming. Have you tried using papaya in infected slough wounds?
When I talked about debridase, I mentioned that it is a combination of papain and urea. So papain is basically extract of papaya. So we are not using papaya as such, but yes, people used to use banana leaves also. If you go to the ancient, desics and all,
Yes,
papain, I'm very sure papain can be used, but of course we are using it in the form of papain.
Papain, right.
Yeah, it causes proteolysis actually.
Proteolysis.
The fluff. Yeah.
Yes, sir. So Dr. Hardeep S. Paul from Jalandhar City is asking, what is the role of growth factors?
Basically, these days everybody knows that PRP, growth factors, they help in the, they promote the healing. Even this is not only the, it is not only in the diabetic foot where they are used. Now people are using in cosmetology also over the face. They're using in alopecia as a treatment of choice, in baldness, and many orthopedicians they are using, muscular pain or maybe tenosynovitis and all. So there are multiple indications for that. And they just, help in the healing of the wound. The principle already, I think I have explained.
Yes, sir.
It reduces the cytokines and all, no? That is, it reduces the inflammation and all.
Yes, sir. Right. Sir, what is the duration that we can use this silver dressings for the wound? So how long can they be tried, or what is your experience with the duration?
Now we have been using for around 8 to 12 weeks. There has never been any problem, because we have not read anywhere or we have not come through any patient where we can say that there is any side effect of silver in general, because it's a nano silver. And I think Dr. Pradeep, you can answer this question on my behalf, because your silver heel is being used, so
right.
you are a better person to answer that question.
Sir, with our experiences, almost there are studies that are available with the silver use for almost 12 to 15 weeks, sir. And some studies are also shown for 6 months also. They have used some case studies are also available. So 6 months to 3 to 4 months to 6 months, that much period we studies are available with us.
Yeah, for so silver. 12 weeks we are using a routine.
Sir, Dr. Suri from Delhi, he is asking, can oxygen supply in the hospital, can it be used for wound healing?
I think, actually it is not possible for me to comment on that, because very recently we had a webinar from US where they do say, yes, you can use it. It is not the oxygen which is available in the hospital, but they say that there is some equipment from where you can generate oxygen. I'm very sure it must be from the atmospheric air. But I think HBO has got very good role as far as the tissue perfusion is concerned. Because, the whole body is perfused, because you put the whole body into the chamber. And in my opinion, hyperbaric oxygen is a better choice than just local application or local, dipping the wound in oxygen or whatever they suggest, in a dressing. So my answer to that question, straightforward, HBO is far, far better in my opinion.
Yes, sir. That is a very crystal clear answer, sir. Sir, Dr. Falgun Verma from Mumbai, he want to know the cost of laser machine and ECMOplast.
And EMCOplast. No, EMCOplast, depending upon the sizes, that is 3x3 or maybe 5x5 or 8x6. It's this 1200 rupees to 2000 rupees each dressing. But in case the wound is larger, you can cut the dressing. Like for example, if the wound is larger and we are having 8x6, so like the way we apply the skin graft, we can cut it and apply it over the wound, and the dressing has to be changed after 3 days. So basically patient saves a lot of money because he need not to come to the hospital on daily basis. So that is a basic cost, and lasers, yes, they are expensive. The equipment which I am using a laser, that is around 25 lakhs.
Sir, Dr. Rajiv Kumar Singh from Mumbai, Maharashtra is asking, is there any role for stabilization of joint in diabetic foot wounds?
That is a part of biomechanics, Dr. Pradeep. I think let's try to time management. Stabilization of joint of course is very important, but then the next question will be on sharp foot. And yes. It's a very vast field, you know.
Dr. Arsalan Ahmed from Varanasi is asking that elderly patients are very wound healing is very problematic in elderly patients. So how can we proceed for bed sore management in elderly patients?
Now, you know, bed sores, basically they are pressure ulcers.
Yes.
So what we can do, like, you know, from nowadays, one Actico dressing is available, which contains silver. And it is available either in the classic form, that is a square shape, or it is in the heel, which you can apply over the heel in case ulcerations are formed over there as a result of pressure. Or there may be a sacral sort of a dressing which is now available. It's a sacral shape, and you can apply over the wound over there. Now that acts as a silver as well as it has got a foam. So the pressure is removed from that part. And of course, proper bed care and all that, you know, the nursing care, that is very, very important part of the ICU management once the patient is old, you know, or maybe lying in the ICU.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Right, sir. Sir, next question is very interesting. How good is it to apply powder from antibiotic directly over the wound? Has it recently?
Yeah, nowadays, you know, it's a generalized perception that there is no point of using topical antibiotics. Now, please bear in mind, you know, previously, you know, even after laparotomies and all, you know, the surgeons, they used to put some antibiotic in the abdomen, maybe something Metrogyl or tetracycline or many things were used. But now it is very clear that there is no role of putting any powder form like tetracycline or doxycycline or anything over the wound. It is a totally gone concept now.
Right, sir. Sir, this is one interesting question regarding the diagnosis. The role of color Doppler in diabetic foot ulcers.
You know, in case it is a varicose ulcer, differential diagnosis, please go for color Doppler. In case you are not able to palpate the peripheral vessels, yes, you can go for color Doppler. But definitely, if you want to rule out any pathology related with varicose ulcers, you should go for color Doppler. You have to rule out varicose veins. And in case the ulcer which is present over there and ABI-TBI is normal, then you can go for compression bandages. That is the standard well for which we use. Even in diabetic patients, it's not a contraindication as far as ABI and TBI, they are normal.
Sir, this is a slightly different question, but that is related to research area field. Dr. Shuvendra Nath Chakravarti from West Bengal is asking, the proportion of wounds that heal completely is a common endpoint in clinical studies that are related to wound care, and that is also insisted upon by the regulatory bodies such as US FDA. Given that chronic wounds are difficult to heal, the appropriateness of such endpoint has been often questioned. What is your opinion, sir?
So basically, I could not understand the question, Dr. Pradeep, I'm sorry. But basically, I think he wants to know that it's an incomplete healing. That I could not actually understand the question, please. Can you repeat it in a very simplified way?
Yeah, sir, often in clinical trials, the primary endpoint taken is that proportion of wounds that heal completely.
Right.
Okay, so here, doctor is asking, what is opinion regarding this endpoint? What is your opinion on taking this endpoint? Or should we consider the studies with other endpoints?
No, endpoint means we want complete healing of the wound.
Yes.
That remains the endpoint, you know. Whenever we are dealing with any ulcer or any wound, we want the wound to be healed. So end point is complete healing of the wound.
Complete healing of the wound. Right. Thank you so much for that.
Yeah, Dr. Pradeep, I would like to share one slide with you. Dr. Pradeep, one slide I have to share on interesting and exclusive sector. Just give me a minute.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I will just share with you. Yeah, Dr. Pradeep, this is what Dr. Sanjay from Bangalore had asked about extrinsic and intrinsic factors. So extrinsic factors, it's a repeated trauma. When I said that prevention means go for offloading or go for any protective measures, there should not be any repeated trauma. Even from the shoes which you are wearing, there should not be any trauma. Second is ischemia should not be there. As repeatedly I'm talking about ABI and TBI, and of course, if poor glycemic control, if you know there is constant HbA1c is more than 7, that should not be there. So these are the extrinsic and intrinsic. Of course, deficiency of growth factors, we cannot measure as such, but yes, PRP can be injected, and then reduced fibroblast activity. If there is reduced fibroblast activity, that is an intrinsic factor, that means the wound is not going to heal. So that is what I wanted to share with you.
Thank you so much for that slide, sir, again. Sir, this is last question of the evening. What is the role of skin grafting? That is coming often in this all the questions. What is the role of skin grafting, especially in deep wounds?
Best dressing is the skin grafting. That is the bottom line. It is the best dressing which is available. Take the skin graft, and apply it over wherever it is possible. Whenever the granulation tissue is healthy, and I think it acts as the best skin graft.
Best skin graft. Right. Thank you so much for that answer, sir. There are various questions that are related for asking regarding credit points. Delegates, we are not currently offering any credit points for this webinar. So I thought of clearing this. Thank you so much for this enlightening presentation and question answer session, sir. Now I request Mr. Alak Trehan, who is the brand manager of SilverX Heal, to kindly deliver the vote of thanks. Mr. Alak, over to
you. Yeah, thank you, Dr. Pradeep. We at Sun Pharma, thank you, Dr. Kamal Gupta, for your valuable insights on time principle in wound management. I'm sure your talk will bring a significant change in the wound management in India. We thank all the delegates for taking out time from their busy schedule to attend today's webinar. We at Sun Pharma will continue to do such scientific programs in future. Thank you.
Thanks, Mr. Prehan. Thank you very much.